all with Health Matters. And as I've been telling you, 2024, we're going to keep it real. And I want to talk about this drug, this epidemic, this crisis, fentanyl, opiates, methamphetamine. You know what's out there. I want to talk from the subject, dying to be happy. But first, let me tell you about some facts. Until recently, suicide, car accidents, cancer, and COVID was the leading cause of death in those ages 18 to 45. But since 2019, the number one cause of death for that age group is fentanyl overdose. Yeah, fentanyl overdose. This drug is 50 times more potent than heroin and 100 times more potent than morphine. Now, historically, it has been predominantly used by white Americans. But of late, it has crossed all racial and gender barriers. And on average, 150 people drop dead daily from an overdose on this drug. And to make it worse, they have now synthesized a new derivative of fentanyl called carfentanil, which is 100 times more potent than fentanyl. Now, fentanyl is causing people to drop dead at a rate of 150 people daily. That's almost 55,000 people annually. How much more do you think carfentanil will cause death by overdose? Think it'll stay the same? You think it'll go down? I'm sure you know the answer. Carfentanil. Now you throw methamphetamine in there. It's still predominantly used by white males aged mid-20s to mid-40s, but even that of late has crossed all racial and gender barriers. It's spreading amongst all races, and it doesn't care if you're male or female. Why use it? Most are running from something, pain, be it emotional, mental, or physical, heartache, loneliness, isolation, looking for something different, looking for an answer to their sadness or their depression, unknowingly self-medicating to try to treat an undiagnosed mental illness. And then some are using it to run towards something, happiness, elation, a sense of boldness and increased confidence, and a sense of belonging. Yeah. But 100% of them will tell you that that pot of gold that they were assuming they would find at the end of their rainbow wasn't a pot of gold at all, but a pile of crap. As they look at their lost life, their lost family, their lost relationships, their lost dignity, their lost worth, and as I already mentioned, oftentimes their loss of life. And as I had mentioned before, over the 20-year period, I have seen over 30,000 of these happiness seekers. And there are three prevailing common denominators that kept coming to the surface as I would talk to them, as some were more open and transparent than others. Three things that kept coming to the surface. One is 100% of them don't like where they are. And would to God that they can get out of their situation. The problem is, nobody told them that these drugs is like quicksand. As soon as you get into it, you're stuck. And the harder you try to wiggle to get out, the more you sink. So basically, you are at the mercy of someone helping pull you out of the quicksand to get your feet on solid ground. And only those who really want to get out will allow themselves the help they need to get pulled out of that circumstance. But three things: broken home kept coming to the surface. And no, I'm not talking about broken home as in divorced home. I'm not talking about broken home as in a single parent home. I'm not talking about a broken home as in there's no father in the home. I'm talking about broken home where many times there are two parents, both professionals, in the ER, scratching their head, wondering what in the world Junior got himself into. And Junior would say, "I would rather, when I get out of school, hang out in the streets, stay high with my friends, than to be in my chaotic household where there's nothing but fussing and fighting, gnawing and gnashing of teeth. But yet home is supposed to be that place of refuge and that safe haven for our young kids." Something else within this broken home is loss of boundaries. Sometimes parents get so busy chasing that bag, chasing that career, not realizing that a child left unto himself is destined for destruction. Within that broken home, there's often no paternal patrol. That's not necessarily saying daddy ain't there. Daddy can be there, but daddy's not present. Daddy's there in body, but he's not presently engaged with his seed, with his offspring. Oh, and kids know it. Sometimes they'll just pop off a conversation just to see if you were listening. And once you finally get over your distraction or whatever's on your mind and say, "Oh, what was that you said?" They already like, "Yeah, never mind. I see how insignificant, unimportant, devalued, unvalidated, unbelonging that I am in my own household." Yeah. The other thing that comes about, again, 30,000 patients over a 20-year period, is mental illness. Mental illness as in this person strung out on drugs always knew something wasn't quite right with them. And all they wanted to do was seek normalcy. They wanted to feel normal, and they never did. They always felt empty. They always felt there was a void. They always felt like something was lacking. And somebody said, "Here, try this." And now they're feeling like Superman. And they feel a sense of normalcy, so it appears. The other is mental illness undiagnosed in the home. There's so much chaos on the daily. There's so much dysfunction that dysfunction has become normal to them. And they would rather spend their wakening hours outside the home seeking a more ideal environment, or worse, wanting to just numb themselves from the craziness in their own household. And they found that just being high all the time on an opiate puts them in enough of a stupor where they can care less what's going on in the other room. And thirdly, and probably more profoundly, is they tend to have an aversion to towards spiritual matters. Why? They often ask the question, why did God have me living with such messed up parents? Why God got me living in such a messed up situation? I prayed, nothing changed. Why was I abused as a child? Why was I molested, unloved, uncared for, unattended to? I must be worthless. At least this drug makes me feel something. Or at least this drug makes me stop feeling anything. God must not be real. I prayed and he didn't answer. Now see, the product of these three common factors is an increased risk for drug use and abuse. And what are we doing about these lost souls? That's really what it boils down to. What are we doing about it? Both health professionals and society in whole. This world on drugs. United States often brags about what they put into it. Since the 1970s, over $1 trillion has been spent on this war on drugs. $1 trillion. June of 2021 made the 50th year anniversary on this war on drugs. And they had calculated that $1 trillion has been spent on this war on drugs. In 1981, the federal government budgeted $1 billion towards the war on drugs. In 2020, they budgeted $34 billion. In 2022, they increased that to $41 billion. And in 2023, they were very excited and bragged about the greatest drug bust in U.S. history when they prevented 130 tons of illicit drugs from entering our borders. Now, imagine a 757 commercial airliner filled from top to bottom, nose to tail, all with drugs. And there you would have about 130 tons. That's quite a feat. Yet, the epidemic is stronger than ever. As a nation, we proudly took pics and we stand beside it. We make videos of all the drugs spread out on a table, showing that our money is paying off. But yet, the drug war is still at epidemic proportion. And in real life, you can often win a battle and still lose the war. Conversely, in 2018, our presidential administration signed into law something called the SUPPORT Act, Substance Use Disorder Prevention and Promotion, or promises on Opiate Recovery and Treatment Act. And within that act, they serve to help recovering addicts to get back to living. Within that were policies that included transitional homes for families, which basically included addicted mothers and their infant children, transitional group homes for individuals. They were to increase the number of inpatient and outpatient facilities. They were assist in job placement. There was, within that policy, was a requirement of regular follow-ups to decrease the risk of relapse. And as a result, there will be a reduction of homelessness and people will start getting back into the workforce and out of the life of vulnerability that subjects them to the very drugs they just got off of by being homeless and walking the streets. At the time of this signing in 2018, 70,000 Americans lost their lives to overdose. That was in 2018. They relooked at it in 2023 and saw that 110,000 lost their lives to drug overdoses. And that was enough to have them be reluctant to put forth any more money into helping those that needed help. They had until September 30th, 2023, to reauthorize this act because it had a 5-year life cycle. Well, September 30th has come and gone. It was not reauthorized. And so the SUPPORT Act is now suspended. No further funding. And on top of that, countrywide, there's been a reduction in mental health facilities being shut down, both outpatient and inpatient facilities, due to lack of funding. ERs are now overwhelmed and at best can offer a 72-hour hold, which we know is inefficient with helping someone get their mind right, get their body right, so that they can be functional people in society. It just becomes a vicious cycle, released from the 72-hour hold with no place to go but the very streets that are destroying them. And the practicality makes no sense at all. Basically, we implemented the SUPPORT Act. People are still dying, so let's stop putting money into it. But yet, $1 trillion has been focused on the supply, in spite of the supply still getting across the borders. We simply just increased the budget. But when money was put into the demand, the end consumer, and we saw that people were still dying, we immediately withdrew those funds. We've put our focus on the sorcerer and the sorceries and not enough on the souls that's being lost. Oh, we can do better. So one might say, you're being unrealistic. We can't go out there and make people do what they don't want to do. Okay. All right. Well, let me just play along for a moment. Let's just say we invested another trillion and we have plugged up every single port of entry of illegal drugs in the United States. I mean, every hole is plugged. Underground, above ground, on ground is plugged. No more drugs are entering. But guess what? You still have 50 to 60 million people that are addicts, homeless, got campsites, walking the streets, now looking like zombie apocalypse, looking for their fix. The supply chain has dried up. So now they're going to be looking in your medicine cabinets, your cars, your glove box, your purses, breaking in the pharmacies, hijacking the emergency departments, because the outcome really doesn't matter to them. If I die, I die. If I get in jail, I get in jail. Nothing matters to a person obsessed, possessed with getting their fix. Nothing will stand in their way. Not your front door, not your security system, not your barred windows. And they will come in droves. So the point is, we're going to have to focus on the souls at some point, Why not on the front end instead of on the back end? We can do better. And we must do better. Now, the latest I've seen is the National Drug Control Budget for fiscal year 2024 has asked for $46 billion to be budgeted for the war on drugs. And as I read through it, $30 million has been allotted for transitional housing program for recovering addicts. You see, because if we don't do something now, it's going to fall back on us eventually. Those working class individuals. You say, how so? Well, how about this? There's a health demise amongst drug addicts. Well, that's obvious. There's meth heart failure. There's stroke. There's aneurysm events. The blood pressure gets so high, the heart's beating so hard that it literally wears itself out. You pop a vessel. That's a medical expense. You all of a sudden, you know, if you're strung out on methamphetamine, you all of a sudden, studies show there's a 5-year period of being on meth where you are at increased risk of meth-related heart failure. And it goes like this. You find that you can't get from one end of your house to the other. You can hardly walk several hundred feet without being short of breath. You look down and your feet are swollen. You're coughing, a wet cough. You show up to the emergency department. They have to put you on oxygen because you're not even oxygenating well. You're admitted. They do an echocardiogram. They find out that your heart is only beating at 20%. That's hardly strong enough to do anything. So they tell you need a life vest, an electrical unit that goes on your chest with electrodes. And when it feels your heart beat irregularly, it shocks you back into a life-sustaining rhythm. Or they place an internal defibrillator. Life just isn't the same for you. And ultimately, they put you on a heart transplant list. Who buffers that expense? They're not. They don't have the resources. They've been castaways. They've been thrown away. They've been on the street. They've just been surviving. So we bore that expense. Or you got the opiate abuser. Day in, day out, an excessive opiates increase vasculature permeability. In other words, your vessels leak out fluid, and they leak out fluid where fluid isn't supposed to be. You look down at your feet, and they no longer have any tone or shape. You can't even see your ankles. Fluid is seeping out. Sores are popping up. You can't breathe. You got this frothy pink foam coming out of your mouth. You go to the ER, you have to be on oxygen, and they tell you you have pulmonary edema, fentanyl-induced, opioid-induced, heroin-induced. Eventually, your heart fails you as well. Life isn't the same. All you can do is wish that you would have been able to stop before it got to this point. But getting on these drugs is a slippery slope. More easier to get on than it is to get off. Then there's those who shoot up. The high is much quicker. Seems to be more convenient, right? Find you a good vein and shoot up. Now you have something called infection of your heart valve, endocarditis. You need valvular transplant surgery. Your valves are shot. Or with that infection, it spreads throughout your body and you're septic and you're in the ICU and you're hanging on for dear life. And on top of all that, you're in withdrawal. Life gets ugly. It's not a pot of gold at the end of that rainbow. 100% of the time, it's a pile of crap. And nobody will tell you who is strung out that life is good. They have been deceived. They have been duped. And unfortunately, they've been stripped of all dignity and self-worth that they feel like, this is where I'm at. This is where I'll always be. And if their health don't get them, eventually they'll get desperate enough to where they'll create some type of illegal act to where now they're in our prison system. So they're in federal penitentiary for some drug-related crime, and it costs about $40,000 a year per inmate to take care of. Who do you think foots that bill? Are we sure we don't want to invest more money on the front end? Because we're going to put money into it regardless. I got a thought for you. You might as well buckle up and put your seatbelt on, because I got a thought for you. There is a place for God and spirituality in a lost soul finding their way back to living a fulfilled life and now having a story to tell and to warn others of the detriment of making that 1 second decision that cost them years of their life. There's a passage of scripture, 2 Chronicles 7:14. And it goes like this. If, in other words, there's a condition. Yeah, there's a condition. Yes, God is love and God is all loving. But there's a condition, and it starts with if. Now, who is the if directed to? Well, it tells us in the following verses, my people who are called by my name. Now, I've heard throughout the years sermons preached on this text, and we've been misled into thinking that God is talking to the world. And we will speak damnable messages on how the world needs to get right. No. This is directly at those who are called by his name. This is directly to those who call themselves believers, those who call themselves Christians, those who call themselves child of God, the redeemed, the heaven-bound, people of faith, faithful churchgoers. He said, if my people, that would be you, who are called by my name. This is what he said. This is the condition. If you'll humble yourself, pray, seek my face, and what? Turn from your wicked ways. Oh, we see what's going on. The church is supposed to be a city set upon a hill, shining its light in dark places. Oh, we see what's going on. We see the epidemic crisis just like the world does. We see people's lives being destroyed just like the world does. But his condition isn't to the world. That condition is to those of us who called ourselves child and children of the King. Why did he say humble ourselves? Perhaps it's because we have forgotten that if it had not been for the grace of God, it could be me on Skid Row. It could be me strung out. It could be me in the quicksand of drugs, feeling hopeless and hopelessness. It could be me in that dysfunctional home where there's chaos every day. And in arrogance, we feel like they brought it on themselves. They made their bed hard, let them lie in it. And so we get better video surveillance systems, better alarm systems, better security for our parking lot to keep them people away from us. Yeah. Humble yourselves. Pray. Seek his face. Turn from our wicked ways. He said, then will I forgive their shortcomings and I'll heal their land. Yeah, this epidemic of drug crisis has the land sick. And if you think it's going to plateau, you're fooling yourself. The sorcery and the sorcerers are two steps ahead of us. They'll make it more potent. They'll make it more cheap. They'll make it more available. And until we learn to focus on the demand, it's just simple business economics, supply and demand. You want a business to leave, then you get rid of the demand. This isn't a charitable industry. This drug game is a profitable industry. And if there's no longer a profit, they will be forced to look for another market. But as long as there's profitability, you plug one hole, they'll find another. You plug that hole, they'll find another. You plug this hole, they'll find another way to get it to the end consumer because there's profitability. But you change the soul of the consumer. Open their eyes. Help them to be woke to where they can see what it has done to them, to where they no longer have a desire for it. And now they'll turn around and tell others to stay away from it. The market will dry up. I can be just as idealistic with that as idealistic as you're being by thinking putting $1 trillion into stopping the sorcerer and the sorcerers is going to stop the drug game. Yeah. There's a story in the book of Luke, 8 chapter and verse 26, that's where it starts. There was a man. He was strung out. Oh, man, he was strung out. Yelling at people that aren't there. Often just had fits of rage and anger. Talk about him having to be in 4-point restraints, 5-point restraints. Got to the point where he busted out of those. And like many people strung out on drugs, it causes paranoia and isolation. He lived on the streets. Didn't he want to be around people so much so that he slept in alleys and amongst the graveyard? But then he met and he had a confrontation with Jesus. This man ran around naked, crazy and out of his mind. I don't know if it was some drugs. I don't know if it was some sorcery that got to him. Everything crazy like that in the Bible times, they just said it was a demon. And we just left it at that. But he was inflicted and controlled by something greater than himself. Isn't that what fentanyl does? Isn't that what heroin does? Isn't that what methamphetamine does? Isn't that what cocaine does? It affected his mind and altered his thinking. He was paranoid. But my Bible tells me that after he met the Lord, he was clothed and in his right mind. Now watch this. Most of the time when someone meets the Lord, as you read in the Bible, after that, Jesus says, "Now come follow me." This man, who was crazy and everybody knew it, who was strung out and everybody knew it, said, "Jesus, I want to follow you." He said, "No, go back amongst your family, amongst your people. Let them see you." I tell you, the best hope for those stuck in the quicksand of drugs is for those who are called by his name will fall prostrate, fast, pray for a breakthrough, have some boldness, as Jude says, to snatch them from the fire and then let the world see the changed man. Because in my encounter with all the people strung out on drugs, they are lost. They are overwhelmed with hopelessness. They feel like they are too far gone and ain't nobody about to help them. Their family has had enough. Their friends have had enough. And in fact, they have had enough themselves. So they're just going to smoke until they check out. They're going to shoot up until they're no more. They're going to dope up until they stop breathing. And that's the only life they see. I'll tell you another story. Mark 9. Young man destroying himself, self-harming, throwing himself around in fires, trying to drown himself in waters. Yeah, he was doing that. And while this is going on, Jesus and Peter, James, and John was up in the mountains. And Jesus transfigured himself. And Shekinah's glory just lit the whole area. And those leading men said, oh, this is nice, man. This is glorious. Let's just set up a tabernacle. Let's just build a church right here. And just worship. Just have a good time in the Lord. Isn't that how we do it? We made our son to go to meeting. We went to church. Life is good. But we forgot there's work to be done in the valley. So Jesus said, no, we can't stay here on this mountaintop. That was just to give us strength to do work. And he went back down into the valley. And there's this boy strung out on something, harming himself, doing things to himself. His dad was frustrated. And Jesus said, what's going on? And the father said, my son keeps trying to hurt himself. He even throws himself in fire, gnashing, gnawing, and pining at his skin, picking at himself. And I went to the church, and they couldn't help. Jesus said, you faithless generation. Who is he talking to? We like to teach that he's talking to the world. But he looked at his disciples and say, you faithless generation, how long will I put up with you? Maybe that question should be asked to us right now. How long should I put up with you? So that was his indictment to those who say they're Christians. And then he looked at the father and he said, how long has he been like this? Now, you don't think God knows how long we've been struggling? How long has this been going on? He asked the father to see if he was an absentee father or a father engaged in his child's well-being. And thankfully, this father knew exactly when this behavioral change started and was able to tell Christ that. And then Jesus said, bring the child to me. Yeah, bring him to me. If thou believe. And the father said, what many of us say when we look at this overwhelming, consuming drug crisis. He said, Lord, I believe, but help me in my unbelief. Yeah, I see it. I see it's getting terrible out there. I fear for my child every day. Because private schools aren't immune. In fact, private schools have more of the pure drugs than some of these inner city schools. Having two-parent homes doesn't make you immune. So we see what's going on, and sometimes it shatters our faith that anything could be done about it. So all we want to do is protect ourselves and our own and our churches. Better security system to protect our pianos our organs, our soundboard, our equipment, while desperate souls are doing whatever it can, or whatever they can, to try to find a piece of normalcy in their life. The father brought the child to Jesus, and you know the story. After some spiritual therapy, after some hard questions, after some relearning and rethinking, this child was made whole. How much more do we need to see? We put billions in everything else. Are there any churches that are 24 hours by chance? I'm just curious. Where the light is always on for lost souls looking for their way? Or is it just that 2 or 3 hour window on Sundays where you better get in where you fit in? Because after that, we out of here. If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves, pray. When it came to that little boy, Jesus said, this type, when a community of people is overcome with something that has taken over their bodies, to where they no longer can see their way, they're in quicksand, they can't get out, it's gonna take fasting and prayer. That's what he said. It took one person to get in that quicksand. It's gonna take a village to get them out. This sleeping giant that we call the church, I'm hoping we'll one day wake up and stop being potential energy and be kinetic energy and motion. And as a whole, fall prostrate before the Lord and fast and show the world the power of God and who they say they believe in. We got people out there dying to be happy. And we're on the insides of these four confined walls singing, this joy I have. The world didn't give it to me. The world can't take it away. And we're not sharing that joy. That's the indictment. And I dare say, the challenge befalls upon us. Not our government, not the person next door, but those who call on the name of the Lord. It's time to let our faith work, because faith without works is dead.